Good afternoon, members of the audience. We move on to the first vision talk of the day. There's an area that one takes for granted, or perhaps not, which is this idea of not just understanding happiness, but trying to see how you can find a modality to compute happiness, if such a thing can be done. One of the first expressions of computing happiness, first official index of happiness that was that came out was in 2005, July, the UNDP Human Development Index tried to put together a happiness index. Although, Vinod, did they call it the happiness index? I'm not so sure that they were ready yet to call it the happiness index, but the research that they had carried out pointed towards nations being ordered in a certain sequence of being happy. And the nation that turned out to be the happiest nation, anybody for a guess? How smug. And but right, who was that? Yeah, it was Bangladesh, which turned out to be the happiest. And the reason for that, in their people's own words, was that life is so tough that if you don't take what you have around you as it comes and be feel good about it, then you're going to be perpetually unhappy, because Bangladesh has a series of storms and cyclones, and there's this aid fatigue around the world, so it doesn't get worse than that for a country. Recently, Bhutan has been voted the first, but there are some flaws in that because of the different indicators used. But this very important topic of computing happiness is going to be addressed, and it's of course the last word would not have been spoken here today, but that's the emerging nature of the subject. As we move on to introducing to you the speaker, who's absolutely eminently suited to do this, and you'll discover why.
A physicist by profession, Vinod Raina is one of the pioneers of the people's science movement in India, having helped set up the All India People's Science Network and the Bharat Gyan Vigyan Samiti. He is a founding member of Eklavya, an organization advocating alternative education, for more than two decades, and the only NGO whose curriculum was adopted in the state school educational system. He has devoted himself full-time to grassroots work. He has been a Homi Bhabha Fellow, a Fellow of the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, New Delhi, and an Honorary Fellow of the Indian Science Writers Association. Vinod was the Asia Leadership Fellow in 2002 in Japan. Vinod has researched and written extensively on the interface of science, environment, and development. He is also the chair of the Asia Pacific Movement on Debt and Development and an International Council member of the World Social Forum. His involvement with ARENA began after the Bhopal gas disaster and the Anti-Narmada Dams campaign. As a board member, he helped conceptualize the Victims of Development project and co-edited the subsequent volume, The Dispossessed. He is also the convener of the ARENA program on Environment Society. Please get your hands together for Vinod Raina. He's going to share his thoughts and his experience on the Eklavya experiment.
Vinod Raina's latest position and engagement is in the area of education for all, which has become his full-time, it takes his full-time attention.
Difficult time, post-lunch after a very long morning session. I don't know how many of you will stay awake. I have a problem. I don't know what I'm doing here, because obviously I have nothing to do with design. Unlike Dunu, I am not a rabble-rouser turned distinguished alumni, which he is. I never studied in any IIT. I obviously have no PowerPoint. You'll have to look at me all the time. So, and I have been hearing the things since morning, which are fascinating, but which are also brainwashing me a bit, particularly the last one by David. And I'm trying to figure out, oh, this is contrary to what I thought about things, which is good because that keeps you a bit awake if you are challenged. Maybe I'm here because there are two keywords, planet and sustainability. And there's something maybe I've been doing around these two words in a completely different arena in the past maybe about 20 years, since the Bhopal gas, but I live in Bhopal. And as you know, the 25th anniversary will be on 3rd December. So half my mind is on the 3rd December Bhopal 25th anniversary, by which time about 22,000 people would have been killed by the gases which escaped 25 years ago. When we talk of sustainability in India, a most often quotation is from Gandhi. Can you guess? Do you know? All right, what else? Okay. Yeah. There is enough on this earth for everyone's needs, but not for their greeds. It's a very often used quotation. There is enough on this earth for everyone's needs, but not for their greeds. And we used to say that Gandhi was very simple and naive because he hadn't contended with designers and advertisers. Designers and advertisers can transform every greed into a need. But what David was telling before lunch, I was wondering, oh, is he saying something different? Is he saying that you can be a designer without trying to turn greeds into needs? Is that what sustainable design means? I still don't know. So therefore, the question will linger on if we talk about sustainability. I mean, we do live in a world now where we do start worrying. You know, I have this Nokia 6710, but the 6303 has come in the market, and that has two additional features which I love. So maybe I should exchange my phone with that. And it gets a lot personal. I go to the internet and see what are the specs of 6303. Oh yeah, it has this thing which I really wanted to have. So maybe I can just tell this guy that I do a buyback and get this one. And in this whole process, going to the internet and looking up things, obviously advertisement and design is playing a big role. But that's happening with everything. It's happening with my clothes, it's happening with my cell phones, with my car. A new model has come, which is terrific. Look at the advertisement about what it can do. And I have an old one, which is 5 years old, and I need to change. So Gandhi never reckoned that need could be transformed like this. And the question is, why is that happening? Why is that happening more and more that all of us, and I don't want to make any distinction, we're all party to that this need to get something which is heavily mediated by advertisement and the design that gets into that is catching our imagination in a big way. There was a time I remember, particularly German advertisements, which would advertise German pens and say, this is for your lifetime. They would make products and they would go and advertise themselves saying that you need not change it. And you would have pens which would go from one generation to the other. Have you ever used a pen in these days for more than 6 months? I don't think we do. We need one more every couple of weeks, I would say. Have you seen advertisements which say this Remington typewriter will last you for 4 generations? If the laptop is 5 years old, my God, it's 5 years, it's a dinosaur, I need a new one. Yeah? Trouble is that sustainability is deeply connected with this. And therefore, I don't think we can get away from it. So a couple of years ago, and it spurred from my work with the Bhopal and things like those, so with a group of people, we started exploring what is the link between consumerism and the feeling of well-being. I feel good. I feel good. So what is this I feel good? Where does it come from? In many ways, and that would be a very long story and I wouldn't want to get it, it is at the heart of consumerism. You consume, you feel good. I teach a paper sometime in China, Hong Kong, and I have very young students there. And when I teach them, I tell them, does it ring a bell with you? They say, yes, yes, it does. If we don't buy anything for 1 week, we feel sick. We feel very unhappy. And they're very honest in admitting that. And if you live in a city like Hong Kong, you cannot but be buying all the time for your own well-being. And therefore, while looking at that, the link between consumerism and happiness, one discovers that, you know, we might be doing our things, but there are certain invisible things that are happening. And these invisible things are in the realm of a bit philosophical, so I will not try to get too deeply into them, but just point out to them. You know, many years ago, or what I should say is that if our problem today is a problem of grand design, it's not the design of a building, it's not a design of a road, it's not the design of a car, it is the design which is called the planet. There is a problem with the grand design. There's a problem with the planet. And as part inhabitants of that planet, we're part of that problem. Question is, do we have a solution to that grand design? Why do we say that? Because we're at the frontier issues that affect life. The very continuation of life has been more or less, we're approximating that, because we're at the frontiers of water, air, and food. And if water, air, and food are under stress, our existence is under stress. So it's not a small little problem of a few trees here, or one pond there, or something here. We are in a major, major problem. So one of the biggest problems for us all the time is to even demarcate between which is a bigger problem and a lesser problem. Is planting a few trees in Mumbai a solution to what? If rainforests are going by thousands of hectares every day, can planting a few trees by school children in Bombay make any dent on that? We don't see those connections. So we feel probably very happy we planted a few seedlings. But that's not going to make a difference if rainforests are going by that amount. But since the rainforests are not in Bombay, so we don't even, most of the time, not aware. But the rainforest going in Indonesia is going to affect us here, because those are the carbon sinks, not the school children's trees here. And once those carbon sinks go, it's going to have an impact here in Mumbai. So they are deeply complex and interconnected things that are happening. It's very peculiar that there's a couple of streams from which you can come to it. You know, the notion of underdeveloped and developed countries, the first time it was ever the world was divided into these categories, can be precisely traced to 4th of July, 1949, when President Truman, in his Independence Day speech, said that, flush after the Second World War victory, that America's role in future will be to use its expertise in science and technology to help the underdeveloped countries, the first use of the word underdeveloped countries anywhere in history, to get out of the misery of poverty so that they are not a burden on themselves and on the affluent regions of the world. And this would be the role US would play. So in a moment, you divided the countries into affluent and poor, developed and underdeveloped. And therefore, all our thinking gets traced to saying, oh, the poor slum dwellers, or the poor villagers without water, miserable, we need to do something, some charity, some education, some healthcare, so that they can become better. So that's our dominant thought. And I think the architecture of this design, at a theoretical level, is this notion that an economic growth leads to better life. Well-being is connected to economic growth. So if you go from underdevelopment or a low-income country to a middle-income country to a high, the vocabulary is like that. You are moving towards a better life. So that's the dominant architectural design behind it. But this design is actually deeper. And this design can be traced back to about 350 years when it was propagated by no one other than Adam Smith. He said, there's an invisible hand which will regulate the economy of the countries. And the invisible hand is the market. It's not the state, it's the market which acts as an invisible hand in regulating the economic affairs, and we should let that invisible hand play its role. And that will lead to greater prosperity. But this invisible hand was made very explicit by two philosophers, Jeremy Bentham and John Stuart Mills, when they posed the questions, what should be the role of the governments? What should governments do? Particularly when parliamentary democracy came, they posed the question, what should governments do? And they gave an answer to. They said the government should try to increase the happiness of the people. Very good and very justified. And then they went around saying, how would the governments try to increase the happiness of the people? It's very long, but in a very one sentence, they said, happiness is ultimately connected to utilities. How many utilities you have? The more the utilities you have, the more happy you will be. And utilities are commodities, which can be measured against money. So food is a utility, transportation is a utility, housing is a utility, but so are services as utilities. Education is a utility, health is a utility. They all have a price. And if governments can increase these utilities, people will be happier. Which gave rise to this philosophical thought called utilitarianism, which along with the invisible hand of the market is the design of this earth. The social economic design of the earth is that, dominant. But the question is, and this is a question some of us tried to ask and many people started asking maybe about 30 years ago, do more utilities or more commodities actually make you feel more happy? Is this true? And in a very seminal book, Amartya Sen confronted this question. The book is called Standard of Living, in which he said, let's take apart this utilitarian argument. Does our happiness have to does it actually depend only on those commodities which can be measured with money? Or are there other areas which give us a sense of well-being? And he asked very simple questions like, if you are well off, does that guarantee you are well? If you are well off, does it guarantee you are well? It may not it doesn't. You could be very well off, but you could have cancer. If you're very well off and you have cancer, you're not going to be very happy. Or you are very well off, but your son doesn't talk to you, or your daughter doesn't talk to you, which is a very common phenomenon, you're miserable most of the time. So being well off is not a guarantee that you are well. But he said, there could be many other reasons which give you a sense of well-being, like the Indian team is winning. We're all happy. It's nothing to do with utilities. It's nothing to do with, you're not getting any money out of it. It's just a feeling you're getting, the Tendulkar has got his 17,000 runs, so. Or our football team is winning. Or you might just, your grandmother might be sick and you might just be nursing her for 1 week and it makes you feel very good. And that, if it makes you feel very good, you cannot put it into a utilitarian framework where you can measure it as a commodity. So the notion that there could be many other ways that a sense of well-being can be there without necessarily increasing your commodities, to which then design advertisement is linked to, are some of the questions which got raised about the notion of well-being and happiness. Why were they raised? Because the question came, this notion that we must go from the lower model of Toyota to Camry and then look for a better model of Toyota which seems to give us great satisfaction. Is that the only way people feel satisfied? And why did that question come? The question came because of a sustainability problem. The question comes because if well-being and happiness are truly only linked to accumulation of commodities, then you need to produce more. Because there is no other way you can have more commodities unless you produce more. But you're getting into a problem. You're, as I said, getting to a frontier where, and I'll spend a few minutes here because I don't know how familiar you are, there is a way to measure sustainability, and by this I mean Earth sustainability, which was proposed in 1997 and is widely used today. It basically is based on the following kind of understanding. If you take five or six essential things for the life, food, air, which means greenhouse gases, marine resources, food, marine resources, not water, greenhouse gas emissions, and three more, and you look at their availability on the earth, and because they were also regenerated, food doesn't exhaust, it comes every season. So they are within the regenerative capacity of the earth. And then you take the entire population of the earth, you can do a measure and say how much of these six together would be available for each human being if we distribute it equally. And this is called the notion of ecological footprint, that if you distributed the ecological resources of the earth, the ones which are important for life, equally amongst people, like you distribute land equally amongst people, then how much would each person get? And the figure is 1.8 what's called global hectares for each person on this earth to live within the regenerative capacity of the earth, which means to live sustainably. Each person can get 1.8 global hectares. So it's like a figure where you can go and check how much is the person using, and you can say, is the person using sustainably? You can do the same for a community. How much is this community using? You can do it for IIT campus. You can calculate for the IIT campus. How much is the IIT campus using? Is it using 1.8 or more? So this is something I can give you references where you can actually, each individual can calculate. Schools, colleges can calculate, a neighborhood can calculate, and you can calculate for the countries. Now, it turns out that an average American's ecological footprint is roughly 11. It's about 11. And the ecological footprint of the most of the Europeans together, all the EU people, is about 8. But the ecological footprint of a Bangladeshi is about 0.5. Do remember that 1.8 is your sustainable ecological footprint. So what does it mean? It means that today's lifestyle, an average American would require 5 Earths to live the way an average American is living, because the ecological footprint is 11. And what is available is about 1.8. So to sustain the lifestyle of an average American, you require 5 Earths. And for an average European, you require roughly about 4 Earths. But a Bangladeshi who has a space for 1.8 is at 0.5, so he's not using 1.3 global hectares. An Indian's is about 1.1, so he's not using 0.4. So there are many meanings to this now. If you're going to say that having more commodities and more production is well-being, as is the argument of the utilities, then to have that lifestyle, an average American requires 5 Earths. But you don't have 5 Earths. And if every Chinese and Indian were to have the same lifestyle and also require 11 Earths, then certainly this Earth is finished. So therefore, the utilitarian argument, if applied to the entire planet, clearly tells you that you cannot achieve that. What does that mean? Does it mean therefore some people are destined to live unhappy, whereas the ones who have more and can live with 5 Earths are more happy? Can you in any case say that an average American has got a better sense of well-being? Well-being is a bit different from happiness than an average Bangladeshi. I mean, half joking and half serious, I might tend to think that a Bangladeshi is a much better, happier person in many ways, even though it doesn't have that kind of utilities and commodities. There's a lot of depression in the US. There's a lot of obesity, we've been hearing about that. And that's not conducive to well-being. You can't be happy if you're always worried about how fat I am. Cannot be good for your well-being at all. So therefore the question comes that we have a problem in between well-being and the demand on the resources of the earth. And if happiness is linked to that higher demand, we have a problem. We can see it in another way. We are at the threshold of climate change. I do agree that greenhouse gas is the cause, but the effect is climate change. And climate change means a complete disruption of water and food systems, and means that this planet is going to change its architecture completely. We're at nearly 1 degree. By the time we reach 3 degrees, this planet will not be the way we're used to looking at it, particularly in terms of food and water. But so we say, oh, we must do something about the climate change. So everyone is going to be in Copenhagen next month and trying to say, we have to save the planet. But is everyone responsible for that problem? Now, Truman said, United States will try to get these miserable people into underdeveloped people into a developed world. But at Copenhagen, 60 years later, I think every country is going to tell you, United States, you are the problem. You better do something. In 60 years, that has completely turned around. Why? Because an average emission from a United States person of carbon dioxide is 20 tons a year. And an average emission of a Bangladeshi is actually 0.3 tons a year. But the first area on this planet which is going to be affected by sea rise is going to be Bangladesh. So Bangladeshis are going to become climate refugees because of a problem that is created by Camry cars and Ford SUVs and so on in some other parts of the world. So are we equally responsible for this problem? We saw that picture David showed us of the people, I forget the name, where they've already been flooded. By the looks of them, we didn't see that they were using 20 tons of carbon dioxide. So they're not responsible for that. So therefore, it's not a question of only the problem that we have. We also have the problem of who is responsible, because we're not all responsible. So there is an element of justice involved in it. You cannot find the solutions by blaming everyone and saying everyone do together, because everyone is not responsible for that. There has to be a system of justice to say the ones who are responsible have to respond. And that's the problem in trying to go around designing campaigns for environment and so on, because it's not a question of saying we have to do something about it. Actually, some of us have to do more about it, not just the international distinctions, but within the country. If India's footprint is only 1.2, it's not because of you and me, because our footprint is very high. It's because of those 800 million people who live below that poverty line of 2100 calories Dunu was talking about, who are actually ensuring that the footprint is low. You and I living in Delhi and Bombay are pushing the footprint much higher. One jet flight, you take one flight from Delhi to Bombay, or you take an intercontinental flight between India to Europe or US, pushes your ecological footprint up there. Because we're burning a small million-year-old forest when we take a flight from here to, say, Los Angeles. We're consuming, each one of us, a little forest which created that fossil fuel. And that, if you do your calculations, I'll tell you how. In your calculation, say I took one flight and see where your ecological footprint goes. So the question is that it's a problem, that there is we and they in that, nationally and internationally. So let's not forget that. But the question therefore is that how do we go about trying to convince ourselves that there needs to be a change? First of all, one of the things we need to do, I think, is if I have blood pressure, I get a blood pressure machine. Every week I put it in and see how is it going. If I have diabetes, I get a glucometer, I put a little drop of blood and see how is it going. And the moment I know how it is going, I decide how to live my lifestyle. So one of the things we do, all of us need to do, particularly who are not digitally divided, who are digitally literate, they need to go maybe every month and calculate their ecological footprint and say, how am I doing? I don't know how many of you do that. But we need to do that, because the health of the planet depends on if we keep on calculating that. And we need to also become conscious to see, okay, what is the Bombay's carbon dioxide emission in 2009 and 2010? We need to take the same health readings of the planet as we take for our own diseases. One, we need to do that. We need to have a campaign to say we need to do that, because the Earth is getting a temperature. And we are the cause of that temperature. We are the bacteria. So if we don't want the Earth to go, because the bacteria will also go, we better check the health of ourselves all the time, because that's leading to the problems of the earth. The second point is, how should we change this architecture of the world, which says that greater production and consumption necessarily leads to well-being and happiness? The question to be asked is, how can people be happy while the earth is also happy? That's the question to ask. Is there a way to ensure that the well-being of people and the well-being of the earth together can be ensured? If that is so, that is true sustainability. Because at this point of time, it says the happiness of people is dependent on destroying the earth more and more. That's not sustainable. So how do you go about doing that? Now, we all like indicators, figures, and so on, because that helps us to fix those things. So they said, if we say that a person's well-being is okay, a person is not feeling too unhappy, there could be many reasons for feeling unhappy from day to day. A boyfriend, girlfriend, quarrel could lead to unhappiness, but we're talking of well-being over a period of time. So we can identify one, which is longevity. Now, it's quite clear that people who live long, or those people from those nations who live longer, living longer is a good indicator that the health conditions are probably better. Because no matter how rich you are, if your health is not okay, you can't have a sense of well-being. So therefore, longevity seems to be a good indicator of the health conditions of a country. It doesn't mean that no one is ill, doesn't fall sick, and so on. But if the average lifespan is longer, that could be taken as an indicator that the average health of the people is probably okay. So therefore, to well-being, longevity could be used, that it's proportional to longevity, your well-being is better. The second was a bit of a complicated thing. They said, can we measure well-being? How do we measure well-being? And that's a tricky one. How do we measure well-being? So some people devised a very interesting questionnaire on a score of 10, which has questions like this. It says, just think for a moment and say, do you think you are somewhat happier today than you were 6 months ago? Or would you say that you're a bit unhappy today than 6 months ago? And if you were to put it on a score of 10, where would you put yourself today compared to six months ago? It might look very incongruous, but I do it with my students. And there are then ways to refine this. It works pretty well, actually. It works pretty well. If you do this and you ask this and people think about it, and they are able to say, oh, if I am the same, then I am 5 points. But I do feel like 6 or 7 points. I'm slightly better than 6 months ago. No, but I am maybe today at about 3 points compared to 6 months ago. And there's a way to check it. Very large-scale surveys of these were done in Europe, covering about 2.5 million people. And many methods were used to make them better. One of the checking is that, okay, I ask myself that question and they're right, but then someone goes and asks 3 close friends of mine the same question. Do you think this guy is happier today compared to 6 months ago, or less happy? Then you compare the score that I give myself and my 3 close friends, and it works very well. It's a very good correlation. So you get a well-being score, which is a self-assessed score. So obviously that's a score you take. So your total well-being is proportional to your well-being at a point of time, your longevity. But what is it inversely proportional to? If you want to take the health of the planet too. Because what we are saying is, can we live in a manner where our well-being and the well-being of the earth both can be together guaranteed? Now, if you are consuming more earth resources, then the earth is not going to feel happy. So the amount of ecological footprint I have, my well-being and the earth's well-being is inversely proportional, right? So I use something like an ecological footprint. So I get a kind of indicator which says my happiness or well-being today is my well-being index into longevity of the population I come from divided by ecological footprint of the community I come from. Okay? I do a bit of mathematics in this, and then I start calculating in the beginning country-wise. And I find, and this, the name for this is very apt for what you're doing here. It's called the Happy Planet Index. It's not happiness of me. It's happy planet. The planet and me both are happy. So this Happy Planet Index, if you do, well, it should be obvious, but it's a horror. The United States ranks at 150. Saudi Arabia ranks at 173. Clearly, unhappy people, unhappy planet, not conducive to sustainability. But island countries like Fiji, Vanuatu, Samoa rank very high up. Very little footprints and a very good sense of well-being. And certainly you can see that if you start using these kind of out-of-box thinkings, which unfortunately are very different from saying buy this car and buy this telephone and buy this cell phone kind of indicators that people use to compare countries, or the GDP growth rates of countries, GNP growth rates of countries. It kind of reverses that. It reverses that, and it tells you that maybe well-being is not necessarily solely linked to amount of utilities you have, solely linked. Why? Because we need to be careful in not trying to be romantic also about the poor people, that the poor people are very happy. That would also be very silly. What we need to say is that there is a basic minimum of utilities everyone must have. The basic minimum of education, the basic minimum of health care, the basic minimum of housing, clothing, transportation, that should be common to everyone. What that common is also can be decided. But very large scale surveys seem to suggest that where affluence and wealth reaches a certain level, then if you add more wealth, it doesn't necessarily lead to much higher sense of well-being. Up to a certain limit, your basic necessities require a certain utility. But beyond that, you add more wealth, more utilities, more consumer products, it doesn't lead to that. And the best part of that came from, again, a very large-scale survey, not of India, where things could be very different, but from Europe, where they asked people to rank which are the areas and activities in your life which give you a sense of happiness and well-being, and from a list of things. Now, interestingly, wealth came at number four. Wealth and consumer products came at number four. What came at number one? Social relations and friends. Now, that's not a consuming commodity. It's not a commodity which is marketable. Number one was social relations and friends. Number two, most exciting, spirit of adventure, meeting new people, sports, climbing a mountain, experiencing a new culture, came at number two. Something new, spirit of adventure. Number three, health. Number four, money and commodities. So therefore, we are speaking from a multi-level system, trying to say that we can have a different meaning of well-being and happiness, which doesn't have to destroy the earth. Now, I think many cultures are unhappy because they have become atomized to an individual. They've become so individualized countries that they have lost social relations. Family relations, marital relations, friendship relations, because of the need for having personal privacy. And I think it's a source of a great deal of unhappiness. Now, that doesn't require commodities. That doesn't require a new Nokia phone. And the Nokia phone doesn't replace those social relationships, as the advertisers will try to tell us. Airtel is very emotional because it connects you. They're playing on something which we deeply feel and saying that it can be replaced by the Airtel. Or the idea phone can replace your teacher, and the idea phone, the teacher talking to you from the US. Nonsense. This kind of advertisements and designs, which are based on the right problem, but using them as a technical solution to solve the human relationship problem by saying the Airtel will bridge your loneliness, which is because of lack of contact with other human beings, or internet will do that for you. Sense of adventure, well, it's up to you. You want to be a tourist on the internet, or you want to actually go and meet people and touch the tiger, as David did. I'm sure if David hadn't touched the tiger and he tried to touch it on the internet, I don't have to tell him what the feelings would be. Wouldn't be the same. That sense of adventure was flowing through his slide out there. I'm sure how pleased he was to be able to do that in Thailand. Well, that does require a bit of travel, but it doesn't mean that you have to go to Thailand every time. It doesn't have to be the tiger every time. Could be many other ways of getting that thrill. Even a game of ping pong can do you very good. So, if we want this Earth to come back to a sustainability level, where we can go to a 1.8 global hectares per capita for everyone, an average American will have to come from 11 to 1.8. You don't realize what economic and technical transformation that would require. And 20 tons of emissions coming down to something like 3 tons of emissions. This is what sustainability will require. And an equity in that. Not that someone can use 20 and someone use 0.2, because that will lead to violence. That will make the difference between the bottles and the big container. If we have to move towards that, we have to get away from the argument, and which is why I think we have to go back to the Gandhian thing, that we have to get away from making every greed into a need. Because it's converting this greed into a need which is finally responsible for an ecological footprint of 11 or 20 tons of carbon. And what, as designers, and you have to do about it, you will think about it. But I see a lot of so-called good design completely wrong on these lines. And I don't think that's a sustainable design. But if at the heart of sustainability of the planet you want to go back, then I think you'll have to completely rethink the notion of design. And that will have many, many manifestations which we can talk about or you can think about. But I see lots of things which are sent around as good design are not good design for sustainability. They might be good design for the sustainability of the jobs of the designers. That's possible. I have no dispute about that. But I don't think that's necessarily towards a sustainable planet. And I think, therefore, there are indicators, there are many theories, there are philosophies, and for all of us here, and particularly for all of you, it's a challenge to go there. Thanks.